to break the yoke and lift the heavy burdens. He is here. He is here to heal the hopeless heart and mend the broken. Come and lay down the burdens you have carried, for in the sanctuary God is here.
Hallelujah, for in the sanctuary God is here. O worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his powerful, his wonderful love, our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Shall we join together in singing this wonderful hymn of worship to our Lord?
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonder and his love, our shield and defense of days, almighty and in splendor, and guided with praise. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space, his chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. The earth with its store of wonders untold, Almighty, thy power has fallen of old, established it fast by a changeless decree, and round it hath cast like a mantle the sea. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light, it streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust and feeble as bread, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Our Heavenly Father, this morning we come with grateful hearts. Lord, we thank you for your blessings. Lord, as the hymn writer has written, we gratefully sing of your wonderful love, our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. We gather this morning, Lord, to give you thanks for your provision, your protection, Lord, your insight into various challenges we may have had this week, that we can look back and say that you helped us through the situation. You gave us insight. Lord, even for those challenges that we are still pondering, Lord, we come to hear from you for a word as we enter into a new week. Lord, even as we gather, we want to remember our country, as we prepare for Hurricane Matthew. Lord, we can only say, Thy will be done. Lord, we pray for mercy. Lord, we pray for wisdom. We pray for those who must needs be out the essential services and those who must be there to ensure that many of us remain safe. Lord, just be with us, Lord. Speak to us this morning once again. Some may have anxious hearts. Some may be nervous and concerned. But Lord, we ask that your spirit may be with us in a special way again this morning, that we'll hear from you. We'll receive a word from you to take us through not only this week, Lord, but until your coming, your return. Lord, bless us, Lord, as we gather, those who will share, those who will sing, the person who will bring the word. Lord, speak to us and bless us in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. We have our responsive reading. Not that we can't praise God in the word, but I want to get my praise on, you know? Our responsive reading 682, Victory Over Sin. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?
God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?
Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death?
Therefore we are buried with him and baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life.
For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should serve him.
For he that is dead is freed from sin.
Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him.
Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, died no more, death hath no more dominion over him.
For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God.
Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lusts thereof.
Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God.
Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a wonderful day it is. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We don't know what the future holds. We know that there is impending hurricane. We know that there's a lot going on. But one thing we can say right now is that we are in a position to praise our God. Hallelujah. Amen. And that is what we're going to do this morning, because he is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah.
Amen. You deserve the glory.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Ready.
Hallelujah.
Check, check, one, yeah.
Hallelujah. We're ready.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing. No rock is going to stand in our place this morning. So it doesn't matter if all the mics go. We are going to give God the glory. Hallelujah.
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 You deserve the glory.
Hallelujah.
And the honor. Lord, we lift our hands. worship as we praise your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship.
Oh, yeah.
As we praise your holy name.
Oh,
for you are great.
You are great.
You do miracles
so,
so great. There is no one else like you.
Oh, yes.
Amen. Sing it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
There is no one else like you.
Oh,
amen.
You
deserve the glory.
You deserve the
and the honor.
Lord, we lift,
Lord, we lift your hands in worship as we praise your holy name. You deserve the glory.
You deserve
and the
honor.
In worship,
as we praise your
holy name, for you are great, you do miracles so great, there is no one else like you. So great, there is no one else like you. There is no one.
You are great.
You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you.
You are Alpha.
Mm-hmm.
we come before you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for everything that is happening now, because we know that you are everything. You are the Alpha. You are the Omega. You're the beginning. You're the end. Nothing can happen unless you give it permission to happen. And so this morning, we have the confidence to know that you are in control. And because we have that confidence this morning, Lord, we ask that you just fill our hearts with praise this morning, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Help us to loose ourselves from the issues and the problems that surround us and praise your name this
Hallelujah.
morning, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Not because Hallelujah. We have done anything that we deserve Hallelujah. To be here, but because we were made to worship you. Let everything that hath breath praise his name this morning. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us, let it rise. If you believe it, sing.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the glory of the Lord.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Lift your voices and sing.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the glory of the Lord.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Don't worship God.
worship you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I feel so blessed this morning to be worshiping God in the home this morning. Am I alone here? Oh God, we give you praise. We give you praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy. Praise
you. You're not a God created by human hands. You're not a God dependent on any mortal man. You're not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is.
Let's do that one more time. We're worshiping God in this place this morning.
You're not a God created
by human hands.
You're not a God dependent
on any mortal man.
You're not a God in need of
anything we can give by your hand. That's just the way it is. God alone, from before time began, you are on your throne, you are God alone, and right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone.
God.
How great is our God?
is our God. Hallelujah. Oh, great is our God. How great is our God. Is our God. In majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, you see how great is our God. God alone, oh, no. From before time began, you are on your throne, you are God alone, and right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone. Alone. From before time began, you are on your throne. You are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone. Awesome is your name in this house this morning, Lord. And we worship you, Lord. We were made to worship you, and help us to remember, Lord, that as we worship you, we are to worship you in spirit and in truth. And so, Father, we thank you for this opportunity that you have given us this morning to come and worship and praise your holy name, notwithstanding what is happening around us, Lord. You are worthy to be praised. And we give you all the glory, all the honor, all the praises this morning, Lord. Hallelujah. As we continue to go through this service, we ask that you just lay your word on our hearts this morning, Lord. You have a message for each and every one of us. And we ask, Lord, that you give us receptive hearts to your will and to your way this morning, Lord. Let the praises continue as we go through this day, Almighty God. We give you thanks and we give you praise and we worship you in no other name but the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please go ahead. Amen. Amen. We want to give God thanks for another day that he has brought us in his presence. And we are here as a people who know that our God is faithful. He is the true and living God, and there is none other besides him. Amen. So even as some may cower in fear and people are busy doing their thing, one of the things and one of the words that God has spoken to my very heart is that this that is upon us is not by chance, but he is still God. And when we are distracted with our busy lives, he has a way of getting our attention. Amen. Reading from Nehemiah, Lord, the God of heaven and earth, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer of your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly toward you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are faithful, you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the furthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for your name. Father God, in the quietness of this hour, we come to you this morning. We recognize you as God. We recognize you as our Father. We recognize you as our strong deliverer. We recognize you this morning as refuge and strength, very present help in the time of trouble. And it is to you we come, O God. You, where there is no turning within, you are sovereign God, and you do not take counsel with any other. You formed this world, O God, with your hands, and you order everything in place, O God. Heaven and earth belongs to you and not another. And it is to you we offer our praises this morning. With our lips we give you thanks, O God, and we worship you in this place this morning. You are awesome, God. And as we've just sung, O Father, unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's who you are, O God. And we affirm that this morning, in this place this morning, that no power in heaven and earth is beyond you, O God. You are supreme God, and we worship you, O God. It is to you we give the glory, the honor, and the praise, O God. And God, we praise you in this place this morning. We lift you up, O God. That though, O God, the outward man is perishing day by day, we can confirm that the inward man is being renewed, because we put our trust and our confidence in you. So God, we come this morning. The cares of Matthew is around us. The cares of our personal affairs are buffeting us in. But this morning we've come, O God, in this place to give you sacrificial praise, O God. That, Lord, whatever is happening on the outside will not deter us on the inside, because we serve a true and living God, one who is in charge. And we give you praise this morning, O God. We command our spirits to praise you. We command our spirits to worship you. We command our spirits to lift you up in this place. Because you say, if I be lifted up, then you will draw all men unto you. So God, we declare this morning that no rock is going to stand in our place. No tree is going to lift their branches in our place. But we are going to praise you this morning. Hallelujah to the Lamb that was slain. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you this morning, O God. We worship you. Oh God, we declare that you are God and God alone. And as we have sung, how great is our God. Yes, Lord, you are the great I am. You are the great I am, the lily of the valley, the brightest morning star. That's who you are, O God. You are conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, and there is none other like you, O God. We worship you in this place this morning, O God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh God, we thank you that you are not like man. Because so many times we failed you. So many times we've turned our backs on you. So many times we treat you like a convenience store. But God, you're still faithful, God. Oh God, we praise you in this place this morning. We do not deserve your grace. But God, we thank you for that unconditional love that you have for such as I. Oh God, many are faults before you this morning, oh God. And like Nehemiah, we have come to confess, oh God. Oh God, not only for ourselves, even for our nation. But God, even before we get there, you wrote your word in Chronicles 7 and 14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek your face and turn from their wicked ways, then you will hear from heaven. You will forgive our sins and you will heal our land. And so, God, we know that judgment starts in the house of God, according to your Apostle Peter. And God, we have come this morning, oh God, to confess our sins as your people before you. Oh God, we as church people, and I use that guardedly, oh God, we are so mixed up and so confused. We have turned against you, O God. In our personal life, we have ignored you, O God. We have gone and touched the corruptible things of this world, O God. We have gone and drink from other cisterns, O God. Cisterns that cannot hold anything, O God. And we have turned our backs from the true and living God. God, we have come here this morning, each of us, to confess, O God, because your word says, if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, God, we do not look outside to those in the world, but right now we ask you to turn the searchlight inside, O God. Convict us of our sins, O God. Convict us of our turning away from you.
convict us of idolatry, O God, in the name of Jesus. Convict us from backbiting, O God. Convict us, O God, and show us, O God, our faults, O God, because they're ever before you, O God. O God, have mercy upon us. We cannot expect the world to get better if we who say we are called by your name are fooling around and playing around, O God. And so, God, in the name of Jesus, I pray, O God, that each of us will see our faults before you this morning. Because your word says there is none righteous, no, not one. And our righteousness is filled to rags before you, Jesus. Oh, God. Oh, God. We come into this place and we carry on as if we are better than others, oh God. Oh God. Forgive us. Forgive us, oh God. Oh God, turn the searchlight on us this morning. And forgive us where we have come short of your glory. Jesus, forgive us. Oh God. God, we become our worst enemies and then we blame it on the devil. But we are being drawn by our own desires, as your word says. The desire to accumulate, the desire to be better than, the desire to be puffed up with pride. Forgive us. Have mercy upon us this morning, O God. Because your word says, a broken and contrite heart you will not despise. So God, we've come with our hearts broken before you. We've come, O God, out of a genuine need of you, O God, and your forgiveness. And we have come to confess, even as we, your people, not only here at Portmore Missionary, but wherever your people are gathered this morning, even as we confess before you, then you will hear from heaven. You will forgive our sins and heal our land. And so, God, we come on behalf of this nation. Lord, there is confusion all around. And just perhaps, oh God, just perhaps, you have sent Matthew here, O God, to recalibrate your people and to recalibrate a nation that has turned to other gods. To recalibrate and to cause us to focus once more on you, the true and living God. And to say that we cannot do anything in and of ourselves, but we are totally dependent on you. Lord, like the children of Israel, Pharaoh's army behind them and the Red Sea in front of them, they had no option but to look up and to call on you, the mighty God, who is mighty to save. And Lord, this morning, oh God, I pray that this nation will know what it means to call on the true and living God. Because so many times, oh God, we have fly in your face and we have done all sorts of evil in your face, oh God. Lord, our country has become a killing field. Lord, we see of what is happening in Montego Bay. and the rest of this island, O God, where we do not value life any longer. And Lord, it is even said that men are drinking blood to protect themselves. But we come against that right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Oh God, we know that this is not your plan for Jamaica. And God, perhaps it is that we are being faced with your judgment of Matthew because we have turned our backs on you. But God, we pray for mercy. We pray that you will stay your hand of judgment, O God, even as we, your people, call upon your name. We ask in the name of Jesus that when this thing shall pass, and when, O God, we would have survived it, that we do not fly in your face and say we did not. But God, we will see you as that supreme God who is able to still even the acts of nature. And you can direct it, O God, away from us. And you, O God, can dissolve it in the sea. So, God, whatever the outcome, you are still God. Whatever the outcome, we are going to praise you just the same. Because you are God and God alone. Oh, and Lord, compared with the wisdom of man. So, God, we ask in this day and in this hour that we, your people, will look to the hills from when cometh our strength. Because we know, God, that this thing that is upon us, O God, is not to destroy us, but to make us better. It is not to kill us, O God, but, Lord, to make us look to you, O God, and be totally dependent upon you. So, God, we offer these prayers in your name now, and we ask, O God, that your purposes will be fulfilled in this church, in your church, that your purposes will be fulfilled in this nation, O God. That, Lord, even now as you bring us, O God, to our knees, O Father, that we will not forget, O God, your mighty acts. Lord, back in the 80s, O God, churches were full and running over because there was fear all around. But, Lord, we have been at ease in Zion, and we sit comfortably in our homes and we do our own thing. But here you are again, Lord, that you alone, that today. And so, God, we come to you and we ask on behalf of this nation that, Lord, your mercy, your grace will be extended, and that you will receive the glory, the honor, and the praise that belongs to you. God, just remember those who are here who are not well, those who are bereaved. Pray for healing, pray for comfort, pray for strength in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that as a people, as we come to worship, and Lord, as your word is spoken in this place, we will receive it with gladness, O God. That, Lord, we will not be so concerned about our personal gratification, that, Lord, we pay no attention to what you're saying to us. So many times it's about our personal affairs. But I pray in the name of Jesus that, Lord, even as your word is open to us, that you will give us spiritual understanding, that we will be the better for it, that we will grow up in you, and that, Lord, we will do exploits for you. We give you praise. We worship you.
We lift up your name in this place because you're worthy of all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. The pastor will now come for the dedication of babies.
While others are finding their way in, getting a seat, we welcome all those on the outside. We want to say good morning, especially to the parents and their little ones that they have brought for dedication here today. The cases have another baby, just in case you didn't know. Another baby is here from Deacon Case and his wife, Marsha. And now we have also Nicole and Carlos, and they have a bouncing baby as well. And so I'd like us to put our hands together and welcome the parents and their babies. Amen. Amen. Standing with you are no doubt some relatives and some friends. And we have some leaders at Portmore Missionary Church here who care so much about you and about your babies as well. And you notice my wife stands beside me as well. We are very, very much interested in babies and will ever be. God has blessed us with children and continue to promise us that he will bless us. And just in case you didn't know, we haven't stopped praying. I thought of these wonderful people coming, daddies and mommies, today, Angie, and I just want to take them back to the passage in the Bible. It carries so many instructions for parents and children and the nation. And I'm in Deuteronomy and chapter 10, and I wish I could read on, you know, these verses, these wonderful chapters, but I have a limited time to do that. As you know, we have other things on the program to do. I start at verse number 1, Deuteronomy. Love the Lord your God. Keep his requirements, his decrees, his laws, and his commands always. Remember today your children were not the ones who saw and experienced the discipline of the Lord your God, his majesty, his mighty hand, his outstretched arm, the signs he performed and the things he did in the heart of his nation. Parents, you have today the men and women of tomorrow to care about. You have today the future of a nation. You have today some world changers in your hands. And God would have blessed you so that you can understand that when you pass this way, then they would have followed in your footsteps. And as you have heard from the word of the Lord, remember today. Today, this is their day. And you can remember today because you had a lot of yesteryears. You had all of yesterday, and in your planning you brought today, the future, to share with us and to commit to the Lord. We do nothing here mystical for your children that would change them and make them Christians from today. But you have a wonderful role to play as moms and dads. And that is to pass along the instructions that are in God's word that you know so well, and that you should desire or strive to know even more. Why? Because you have a great responsibility to train up these young ones in the way that they should go, so that when they become older, they will not depart from it. They will know the instructions. And hear what verse 2 says. Remember today your children were not the ones who saw and experienced the discipline of the Lord your God. God no doubt has reflected and demonstrated for you how much he cared. The fact that you exist today, and the fact that you can be carrying a baby and dedicating a baby to the Lord, means that you have experienced the hand of God. God has tremendously blessed you so that you now can share those blessings that God would have them share. There is a lot that you're going to have to deposit in their lives, and God expects you so to do. Because when he demonstrated while on earth in the flesh that he loved and cared for children was when he said, no, don't keep them from me. You know, don't stop them from coming to me. Permit them to come to me. Do not forbid them from coming. And that time he showed love and he showed care, and he showed, you know, that you know he wants them to be supported. He wanted them to be blessed, and he wanted parents all over to understand that there's a God who loves them, and if he loves them, we too must love them. And ever so often we sing it: Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. He loves them, for he loves you. Let's sing that wonderful song, a verse or two of it, as we prepare to present them to the Lord.
Good morning. So I have beautiful Aubergine Webster. Got that name right, right? Okay, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are so grateful this morning for life. And in particular, we thank you for the life of Aubergine Webster. You have given her to her parents to care, to protect, to provide for. And so, Lord, we pray that you will enable them so to do. And this morning we dedicate Aubergine to you for your use. We declare, Lord, that she will come to know you as her personal Lord and Savior very early in life. We declare that she will be a woman of worth. We declare, Lord, that she will go through her developmental stages successfully. And so, Lord, we lift her up to you and her parents and ask, dear God, for an uncommon favor and blessing in their lives. And Lord, we also pray that you will continue to use them to do that which is your purpose for this child in this world. We thank you, we bless you, and we praise you for Christ's sake. Amen.
And equally, Heavenly Father, as we continue to beseech you, we want to lift up Justine to you. Even as we lift up the parents, we thank you that you would have blessed them already and you blessed them again. We thank you, Almighty God, that we can depend on you for all that we need, for you are source, you are strength, you are enabling. And so, Father, we want to thank you that those who depended on you in the past can still depend on you because you are a faithful God. We thank you that mom and dad know you personally and are committed to you and are committed to taking care of their children. And this new one born to the family, we ask, Heavenly Father, that you would continue the good work you began. I pray that this life will be meaningful to society. We pray for covering, we pray for protection, we pray for provision, divine preservation, O God. That nothing will harm this child and nothing would destroy what you would establish around this character, that it would be the character that you'd be pleased with. Father, we bless your name and thank you for how you have wrought the miracle and that you will continue so to do. Just in case, may God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Almighty lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. They both cried, but the Lord blessed them just the same. Jesus loves the little children.
or white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little child of the world.
Amen. Amen. Morning, everyone. Great to see you in church this morning. We want to welcome those who are here within the sanctuary and those who are joining us via the internet feed. So glad that you're able to join us. Just checking if there is anyone visiting with us for the first time this morning, your very first time worshiping with us here at the Portmore Missionary Church. Any such individual? One? Okay, two. Two persons, three, four. Okay, all three here supporting. Okay, great. We want to welcome you. Let's give them a warm Portmore Missionary welcome. And the ushers, they're going to slip your card, going to ask you to complete it and drop it into the offering plate later on in the program that you can. Be in touch with you. And of course, if you don't have a regular church home, then like I always say, we have enough doors. You're welcome to come and fellowship with us here at the Portmore Missionary Church. Want to welcome especially Mr. and Mrs. Edwards. I don't see them. I know formerly Shani. Where? Okay, yes, there they are. Mr. and Mrs. Ed, come on, please stand. Let's welcome you. Great to have you with us this morning. Yes. Praise the Lord. We rejoice. Long time no see. Yes. We are on the eve of. Now, I am not employed at the Med Service. I'm not an expert, but I follow these things. So I want to encourage us as a church community, if you have not completed your preparations, do so today. I suspect that after service, we may need the assistance of some of the men. I think we still have an issue here, so we may need to remove the speaker and secure some stuff. So. Immediately after church, men, we're going to ask if you can just gather that we can secure some stuff here to ensure that we don't suffer any loss or damage to various equipment we have here. It is forecast that we will begin to experience the winds this evening, and tomorrow should be a pretty busy day. Remember those who are not here and are concerned about what's happening here. Our own Deacon Wisdom is in the Bahamas. He's supposed to return on Tuesday. That looks unlikely. And bear in mind, after the hurricane passes us, it is going to the Bahamas. And the Bahamas not big like Jamaica. So, be in prayer. Not hearing? Those monitoring upstairs, the house is low. Are you hearing me now? Any better? The house monitors need to be turned up so that. Are you here? Can you hear me now? Any better? You're not responding, so I suspect. Are you hearing me any better? I probably need to talk louder as they are just upstairs. So, it's called a microphone. Okay. And want also to remember those within the fellowship, in fact, those who must be out, emergency services and such the like. I suspect we have some persons in our fellowship that will be out for one reason or another from tonight throughout the storm tomorrow. So please remember them in prayer. Some announcements that are in your bulletin, just to highlight their men's retreat coming up on October 29 from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Kendall Camp and Conference Center. The men are asked to support that. Our own, and I say our own, Elder Noel Brown, he come out of Portmore Missionary Church, you know. He is the National Men's Fellowship President, and so he would certainly enjoy our support. There's going to be a special health talk this Thursday, October 9 at 6 in the evening. Holistic Nutritional Counselor Dr. Hotep will present on various issues for all age groups, so please come out and support that. And all persons who signed up with the Senior Citizens Group for membership with the Heart Foundation, your yearly subscription is now due. Please see Deaconess Portuando, or you can call her. The number is there, 988-3040. And a reminder, we have the benevolent barrel that's kept out. Is it still out there? Inside the hall. Please bring non-perishable items to place in the barrel to support the benevolent outreach program of the church. Remember our Deaconess Margaret Barnett, who lost her mother, Maiseline Fowlin, and the funeral service will be held this coming Saturday, October 8, at Calvary Gospel Assembly, 10 a.m. Transportation will be provided at a cost. And the PMC outreach, I think this will be the final one for the year, October 21 to 23, in the PMC car park, and also at the Portmore Town Center, October 21 and 23. Just checking, any other important notices, Pastor? Okay, we invite the ushers to come forward to receive the morning's tithes and offerings as we join in singing the hymn, To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Hath Done.
To God be the glory, great things He hath done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord! Praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of God, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes
and comes
from Jesus a pardon receives.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord,
let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice.
Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son,
and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Great things He hath taught us, great things He hath done.
But
o'er and higher,
and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth
hear His voice. Praise the Lord,
praise the Lord, let the people rejoice.
glory.
Shall we stand as we sing the chorus once again?
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice.
Oh, come
to the Father
through Jesus the Son.
Father and God, we thank you for having brought us back to your house once again so we can worship you. We come before you with humble hearts, giving thanks, O God, for everything that you have blessed us with. And as we come, return a portion of our gifts back to you for use in your kingdom here on earth. We ask that you bless it, that you multiply, and that you give wisdom to those who have the responsibility to decide how it is used. Father God, we present to you also our walk-up gifts which is to follow. We ask that you take it and that you use us in your mission field to expand your kingdom here on earth. We give you thanks, we give you all the honor, all the glory, all the praise. Amen.
Amen. Amen. As you prepare for the walk-up offering, just a correction, the health talk is actually next week Sunday, not Thursday, next week Sunday, the 9th of October, 6 in the evening. I'm going to ask the musicians to play as we have the walk-up offering. Amen. Amen. We're going to have, we invite Sister Cecile Drummond to come with the prayer for the children, asking Sister Pearline Jameson to stand by to come right after with the reading of God's Word from Colossians chapter 3, and then the Portmore PMS Ensemble will bless our hearts before Pastor comes to share the Word with us. So I'm going to ask the children to come forward as we prepare to send you off.
Little children, rejoice, you're a child of the King. Rejoice, you're a child of the King. Children, please get in a straight line. Let us pray. Almighty God and our Father, close your eyes, children, please, all of you. Close your eyes and don't look around. Almighty God and our Father, this morning as we come to you, Lord, we want to give you thanks for today. We thank you for your love. We thank you, Lord God, for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. We pray, O Heavenly Father, that you continue to be with us throughout the service. We ask your covering, Lord, over Jamaica, over our leaders, over your people, Lord. Cover us under your blood, Lord Jesus, as we anticipate the coming storm. Father God, we put these children before you this morning, and we pray, oh God, that you will be with them as they go to their small church, Lord. We pray, oh God, that you will comfort their hearts. Hush them, Lord Jesus. Help them to listen carefully to what the teachers have to say. We pray, God, that they will hear and they will listen and they will, oh God, impart what they have learned when they go home to their parents. We pray, dear God, that you will continue to be with them, guide, protect, and keep them, oh God, from danger. Lord Jesus, these little ones do not know what it is to go through terrible times as storms and earthquakes and all those devastating problems. But Father God, we know that you're a God of comfort, you're the God of love, the God of peace, and you will strengthen their hearts, dear Father. Bless them now as they go over to their church, Lord. Bless the teachers and all who will assist in keeping them calm. Father, we thank you again for your love. We thank you for your mercy and your grace. Bless the rest of the service, Lord, we pray. And bless our speaker. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
You're a child of the King. You're a child of the King. Rejoice. You're a child of the King. Lift your head up high and rejoice. You're a child of the King.
We ask that we prepare for the reading of God's Word, taken from Colossians chapter 3. We invite Sister Pearline Jameson to come.
Good morning, everybody. A reading from the Word of God. Please turn in your Bibles with me to Colossians chapter 3, and I'll be reading from verse 1 through to the end. Colossians chapter 3. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. For which things say the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in the which he also walked some time when he lived in them. But now he also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on therefore as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. that the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Servants, obey in all things your masters, according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of persons. This is the word of the Lord.
A reminder that this being the first Sunday, we have communion service right after our main service. And a note that Calvary Gospel Assembly is on Sundown Crescent, that's off Malines Road, just past Foss Ridge, if you're coming down from Halfway Tree. So for those of you who would like to support Sister Margaret on Saturday, we invite the PMC on Psalm to bless our hearts with a special number, after which we'll hear our pastor share from his heart what God has laid upon his.
You.
Good morning. You sound like the weather. Good morning. I want to thank the ensemble for that wonderful piece. Great are you, Lord.
Christ alone.
Great are you, Lord. I love that. So encouraging. I got a little turned off. One of my elders said something, and it's a pity he said it. He should not even open his mouth. And I was a bit turned off, you know. But Ansam, thank you so much for encouraging me. There was one elder, I won't call any name, but he drew close to me and he said, by now I think you get the message. Stop asking Sister Angie for another child. That's why the Casey's child behaved that way. The child was just hungry and needed milk. And I never had the breast. So the child screamed. Okay? That was all. So I will ask Sister Andrew to deal with that elder after church in some way or the other. It's always nice to have people who were once here with us. And Shani, I'm tempted to say Shani, but it's Shani, Roper Edwards, so nice to hear she was in, but can I tell you this, when I looked around there before and I saw the face, I really thought that the person seated next to her was her daddy. Can I tell you, I don't know if my daughter is going to do something like that. Marry somebody looking like daddy. Well, in case she does that, then I wouldn't have to make over that man. He would be perfect. And I presume that is what Shani did, so that daddy wouldn't have to do any makeover. But that's awesome. We're looking forward to welcoming Sharon Scott in our communion service. She's been worshiping with us for a long time, and she's going to be getting the right hand of fellowship. It's always a joy to have people joining us, and her family, her husband and her sons who come to this school, we welcome them very, very much. Grace, I can see you, and I always recognize you for your smile. It's so nice to have you, but like I did the last time, I will do again. Where is your husband? You left here and you invited me to join you together with a man. I want to see him with you all the time. I understand he can't be here. Is it that area you are in St. Mary's, Spicy Grove? Is there going to be a Spicy Grove Missionary Church soon? I just thought of that. Should I begin to pray? I'm saying that because as a missionary church, we want a church in St. Mary, and we're longing for one in St. Anne as well. We don't have a church in St. Anne either, and I'm just thinking that you'd be so close to us to come over and help to umbrella you as you think ministry. They have a wonderful ministry going on, Danny and Grace, over there in St. Mary, and we continue to pray and support. The name doesn't matter, but you know, it's easier to call it Missionary Church. We pray God's blessing on your lives as you continue the work there, over there in St. Mary. This is perhaps the smallest gathering I've ever seen for my almost 5 years here on a first Sunday. First Sunday is usually the Sunday we are full out because we're expecting the second service, the communion service, that is, that, you know, we all commune together. And last month, when I returned to you, we were in good numbers. What a guan. Mr. Matthew? Well, he's not here yet. We can't be, you know, hiding from Matthew. No, it's best we greet Matthew. Don't hide from Matthew. Well, I'm glad that with all the preparations we have to be doing, you notice there's a slight little shift too from what we saw originally. We've been praying, and let's just trust the Lord, and you know, all he does is perfect, and there's nothing new to him, but we put our lives totally in his care. And although we are scanty today, and no doubt think that we all want to get out of here to undo some more preparation as we anticipate this hurricane, we trust in our great God to watch over our lives and to see us to a calm after the storm. We've been studying in Colossians, both in the Bible engagement, and we've been pulling from it in the midweek study as well. And we're reading ahead of ourselves. We will continue to read from this wonderful little book, because we've noted that it is very, very interesting to see how the writer exalts Christ, to see how the writer invites us to recognize the supremacy of Christ, the sufficiency of Christ, and the Christian standing in Christ. For those three subjects help to epitomize, to summarize what is in this letter that he wrote from prison as he seeks to make God's church better, with all that would happen in the church of the Lord Jesus. And nothing is new to the church. What happened in the Colossian church is not new to the church today. The one we gather in, we always have issues, and we always have to deal with the issues. But in all of it, we have to see always the supremacy of Christ. We always want to note that he is sufficient, and he is the one who makes it possible for us to be participants, you know, in his church, because we have a standing. I wasn't with you last week, but I understand how powerful that word was. And when I listened to it later, I sensed, yes, indeed, here is someone telling us who we are again in a different way. Did that preacher tell you that we have a passport? Do you remember that message? Which is so true. And you know the significance of a passport. And you understand something last week about your position, huh? Your position, your pursuit as you continue this walk, and how important prayer is for power. Am I preaching his word? Yes, I believe that it was a word that clarifies for us what Paul wants us to note. Remember first Sunday when I was with you, I talked about his sevenfold
prayer. And that's where the preacher was ending, summarizing things last week, don't it? How important prayer is, for in the first chapter, there's a sevenfold prayer that is offered there. And then as he closes the book in the fourth chapter of Colossians, he's also talking again about the importance of prayer and educating people as to how they should pray and why they should pray and when they should pray. And God knows, brothers and sisters, when we listen to Paul, it seems we have not yet started to pray as we should. I want us today to linger a little longer. We're reading ahead of ourselves in chapter, two just now, earlier? Three? Yes, chapter three. And we were pulling from that for two consecutive weeks in the midweek meetings. But I want us not to jump away yet from chapter one, because like we would have seen a sevenfold prayer that Paul wanted us to learn lessons from, I want us to note that there are some seven superiorities that is worthy of notation as we look at how he tries to unfold for us and tries to amplify for us the truth about the fact that he is supreme. There is no one like Christ. There is absolutely nothing else that matters in the church of Jesus Christ than the one who is the center of the church. The one that sits high and the one that looks low and the one who has all authority in his church. And I pray that when we are all done the series in the Bible engagement and in the preaching and from the pulpit and in the study on Wednesdays, that we will come to acknowledge that the church is the Lord's. That this is not about Pastor Colquhoun and some elders and some deacons, and it's not about us. It is the Lord's. We will sit at a table of communion in the second service, and guess what? The focus is going to be on him, yeah. The Lord. Why? Because we find these seven superiorities because he is exalted. Paul wants us to know that it is because of the exaltation of Jesus, he is Lord, that we see these superiorities. A greater than angels is here. A greater than the prophets is here. A greater than the patriarchs is here. A greater than the apostles is here. There is none. Last Friday night, Elder was praying and we were just hearing the word of God coming out of that prayer, Elder Rooms, and he was talking about no one is beside him. No one is before him. No one is behind him. No one is underneath him to overthrow him. Why? Because he's the exalted Christ. And he is our all in all. That's what comes out of Colossians. And we're going to have to understand it for what it is. Look there in these verses, chapter 1, verses 15 through 20. It's time consuming. You'll have to sit by yourself like I have been doing. We can't cover it in one day. We can't explode it. We can't even summarize it after we're through with the series, because so many things are coming out when we understand that he is one, the image of the invisible God in Christ alone, that he is the firstborn over all creation in Christ alone, that he is before all things. In Christ alone, he is the creator of all things, as he is before all things. And folks, he is the head of the body, the church. He is the sustainer. He is the firstborn from among the dead. In Christ alone. I don't know, Brother Scotty whispered a song in my ears while the praise and worship was going on Friday night. I don't know, remember if that song was In Christ Alone, Scotty. But you never knew what you did. I know you wanted them to sing that song. It never got sung, but I sat there, just the words he whispered in my ear had me rehearsing a complete message, and I thought, wow, how beautiful it is for us to assemble ourselves together, and it must be the reason why the brother just whispered that song in my ear. Huh? I was preaching a message all over and over, and this is, in essence, what it is: in Christ alone we put our trust. In Christ alone we stand. In Christ alone we live. In Christ alone we are who we are. In Christ alone we are whose we are. In Christ alone. And when you and I come into relationship with God, we come in relationship with God through Jesus Christ, the one who came, who reconciles us. If you read further down in the chapter, you'll hear about him as the reconciler, the one who is redeemer. And that's why Communion Sunday is so important to us, because we see one who came for us in the slave market of sin, and one who bought us in there and brought us out of there and ensure that we are free indeed. For if the Son sets us free, always free, we'll ever be free. For he sought us, he bought us, and he brought us out of the slave market of sin. That's the work of Jesus. That's the work of redemption. That is the reconciling that he has wrought. Christ alone. In Christ alone. But you know, I was just blown away when I looked, you know, for myself at these superiorities one by one, and I thought, the image of the invisible God? Yes, the invisible God. And so right down through 15 through 20, supremacy in creation and supremacy in redemption. That was the song he was singing. That was the message he was preaching. He is supreme in creation. And like that's not enough, he is supreme in redemption. Folks, do you know what it means when we look at the image that he is the image of the invisible God? Seven times Paul mentions in this little portion, read for yourself, 15 through 21. Seven times he mentioned all creation, all things, everything. Meaning Christ is supreme over thrones. Christ is supreme over powers. There are thrones in this world. There are powers in this world. He is supreme over rulers. There are rulers in this world. He is supreme over authorities. There are authorities in this world, in high places, in low places, in physical places, in spiritual places, authorities here and there. He is supreme, not only in thrones and powers and rulers and authorities, but in angels. angels, or if you please, in angelic authorities. Because those visitors that they had in the church at Colossae, I want you to remember that they would have, you know, with their philosophies and with their, you know, Gnostic teachings, were indicating that, oh, Jesus can be considered just another spirit among the spirits. And that you can, and he is not who the Bible says he is. Folks, we're going to have to understand for ourselves what God's word is saying when we come into relationship with him. And here's where I'm going. There are times when we come into relationship with God and we fail to leave the baby state. There are times when we come into relationship with God and we refuse to grow. How? In grace and in knowledge. If you listen, if you study this book carefully, this little letter carefully, you'll understand that he's talking about knowledge. And he's talking about knowledge and more knowledge and even more knowledge. Because he wants people to understand what's there in God's word. We better grow or else we can become confused. And it's not amusing when Christians become confused. Because it's not a very good message we're sending to the world. We need to know what's in God's manual. Yeah. We need to embrace God's manual. We need, brothers and sisters, not to just be drinking milk, but knowing the sincere meat of the word. Oh, my eyes just caught the nails. And it's the right time because you always talk about growing in the Lord, Brother Neil. And it's great that you guys are here. Listen to me, folks. I want us to understand how important it is for us to pass the baby stage and get into this relationship and understand all that Christ is in us, for us, with us. We need to get there. The image of the invisible God. I just couldn't get past that because it is telling me that Christ is supreme. The image. Christ is called the image of God here. And then when you go into 2 Corinthians 4, then you will also note, and perhaps you could turn there, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, because that caught my eyes a few days ago. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Hope I'm leading you to the right passage. I know it's somewhere here in 2 Corinthians chapter number 4. And it coincides beautifully with this passage that deals with the image, yes, of God. Christ being the image of God. As if we can locate that verse. Second Corinthians chapter 4. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is, yes, I think I'm right there. He is what? The image of God. Yes. The exact likeness. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus. Or Jesus Christ as Lord. This is talking about his supremacy, folks. And ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God who said, let light shine out of darkness, made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. in the face of Christ. We could continue to read here, but this is beautiful. I got in the spirit when I read that, and I was just thanking God that, you know, Jesus came. But I thank God for Jesus in my life. So now I have not just the passport the preacher says about, but the position. And I can also be salt and light in the world and tell the truth about who I am in Christ. It is about his supremacy, his sufficiency, and my standing in Christ. Awesome. My standing in Christ is important. I think the preacher also used last week an illustration. There are folks who today say, you are too heavenly minded, but no earthly good. And he brought out the truth in all of that and made us think contrary to what we believed long time. And I thought, yeah, it matches very, very nicely with what I taught as I live in a dark world. And as I go through the dark shadows, sometimes the shadows are thick. And we call it the great tunnel. And we have a saying, it's not true, that it's at the end of the tunnel the light is. It's not true. That too is not true. There's a, if you are in the tunnel and you are in Christ, there's a light that will take you to the end of your tunnel. Though dark it may be, and though difficult this Christian life may be, at home, at work, wherever, and the chaos that is created, where the darkness is so thick and the world becomes so crooked, the light that is in me takes me to the end of the tunnel. There is no light too dim in the dark. Light shines no matter who you are. You may consider yourself a little person, not significant, not important in the eye of society. If you have Jesus, you are a lamplighter. Hello, you leave a corridor behind where some who struggle in the darkness of sin will be able to come to the light, who is Jesus Christ. And that's the wonderful picture that we see when we see the image of the invisible God in Jesus. And when we receive Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord, we are the same again. So no false doctrine should blindfold you and confuse you. You are in Christ. Any man who is in Christ, he is in a new position, as he is a new person, and he begins to perform in a new way. Why? Because he is in Christ. We believe in the supremacy of Christ, and we believe in the sufficiency of Christ, and we believe in a standing of the Christian. He is in the Lord. I love that. I get excited about that when I understand who I am. What is this then before us? If you go to another reference, I think it's Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. It coincides beautifully too with these passages we have just read, especially from 2 Corinthians 4. For in Hebrews 1, 3, what is it that you see here? He is described as the what? The radiance. Look at it for yourself. Verse 3 of Hebrews 1. He is the radiance of God's glory. And so you become in Christ and the exact representation of his being. That's who you become in Christ. Now this figure of the image suggests two truths. Truth number one, God is invisible. No one has ever seen him, but Christ has declared him. Christ is God in the flesh, in human flesh. But here is the second truth, if I may make it quickly. Not only is God invisible, but Christ, who is the eternal Son of God and who becomes the God-man, he reflects and he reveals him. the truth about God can be known because Christ came to earth. And the truth can continue to be known. Why? Because you now are in Christ. He has left the scene, but as he is, come on, help me. So are we, John says, in the world. Oh, it's full time we begin to know that we are little nuggets of truth. We are the truth nuggets of grace. We are little nuggets of this God who was in the flesh. And we walk and talk and look like him. Why? Because we too are his witnesses in the earth. No one has seen him, but everyone can see him. It's kind of a mystery, right? No one has seen God, but everyone can see him, and we can come to know him. The mystery, the truth is in Christ alone. He's superior. That's the message we preach. He's superior. Now, what has that done for us? And what will that continue to do for us? You and I must agree, folks. As long as we are here in the earth, and as long as Christ tarries, this world will have to acknowledge the Almighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, because he has made it possible for this image of the invisible God to be known on the earth. But I like this other one that we could spend a lot of time on as well, that we don't have in just one day or in one presentation. For not only is he the image of the invisible God, but he is the firstborn over all creation. You notice that? Is that in your Bible? He is the firstborn over all creation. And that suggests three things. One, Christ is prior to all creation. Two, Christ is the agent of all creation. Three, Christ is the goal of creation. And when we try to digest this, what we've come to acknowledge, friends, in the teaching, he's not just, creation is not just by him, you know, but for him. Creation not only came about because he spoke things into being. It is for him. This world is for him. You know, we have trouble from Dan to Beersheba. From Moran Point, we would say to Negril Point. But there's one thing that is safe. We're not going to wake up and miss any mountains. We're not going to miss even the water from the sea. We're not going to miss fresh air to breathe. Listen to me, we have some bad people in this country, and if they could take away the air from us and take away the mountains from us and take away the beautiful canopy of the then teeth, you see, they would. But this world belongs to God. We can't shake it. The mountains cannot be shaken but by God alone himself. The earth cannot be removed but by God alone. Hello, folks. The beautiful canopy of heaven remain decorated by the glory of the invisible God. It's his. And when we come to worship, we celebrate the awesome power and the awe-inspiring God. Let go and worship him. Clap your hands. Shout for joy. Listen to me. The earth may be troubled, but God's people who have breath must say, praise the Lord. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. You know, I take trips to Dovecot and Medarest and all these cemeteries very often. And long after people sing on lower body, the places are still and quiet like a graveyard. It ain't a graveyard. Yeah, it is. But you and I, who have breath, must understand we ain't dead yet. But God calls us to praise Him, because the heavens do declare the glory of God. And if worship is what it is human response always to divine revelation. For the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth His handiwork, and day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. God is there. He's God of creation. Hello, folks. He's God of salvation. And we can praise Him like that. The image of the invisible God and the firstborn over all creation. I love that. I want to preach up the storm before it comes, because there is enough in the word that can keep me firm. The Lord's our rock. In Him we hide. The shelter in the time of storm. A shade by day, defense by night. A shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land. A weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock. Let me preach it today, folks. In a weary land. A shelter in the time of storm. Don't we all know what it means then? That we would say like the psalmist, I will make my refuge in Him until all the calamities of life are overpassed. Oh, safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on His gentle breast, there will my soul forever abide, and sweetly my soul shall rest. Nothing can ruffle our feathers. Nothing should ruffle our feathers that easily. When we know Jesus, we shouldn't be shaken by anything like that. For we know the Supreme Lord. We know the shelter. We know in Him we are safe. We are, as it were, comprehensively covered. Whether in life or in death. So don't even worry yourself. What will this storm bring? Don't even worry yourself. You lose an arm. You lose your life. You lose some kind of material possession. Listen, you're safe in the arms of Jesus. You are still covered. You are His. One songwriter said, I am His and He is mine. Come on, tell somebody, He is mine. It is the truth, folks, that we sometimes don't understand who we are and whose we are. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless His name. Hallelujah. Christ is prayer to all creation. Christ is the agent of all creation. He is the goal of all creation. He's not just here because He came at a particular time. He always was. He always is. He always will be. This speaks of supremacy. All of the thrones, all of the authorities will crumble. They will come. They will grow. Kings will come. Prime ministers, you name it, presidents, they come and they go. People get old and retire. People sometimes are shortchanged. Sometimes it is that people have to pack their bags and go. But listen to me, my friends. There is a person who sits high and he never can be uprooted. He is Jesus. Who is He? He's Jesus. He's unmovable. There is one who is undisputable. Who is He? He's Jesus. There's one who is unshakable. Who is He? Come on, church. We're talking about the supremacy of Christ. The supremacy of Christ. But I'm just so taken aback when it says to about this particular superiority, that He is not just creator,
and the image of the invisible God, but he is sustainer. Isn't that amazing? He is sustainer. We can commend and celebrate human skillfulness, call it engineering skillfulness and architectural skillfulness. I've been to a lot of countries in this world and I've seen nothing but that. Engineering skillfulness, architectural skillfulness, until there is a little disaster and all the beautiful lights are out. All the light posts them drop down. All the twin towers are taken down. And listen to me, folks. We think that we have arrived. We've built our little towers of Babel. And we sometimes think we have it crisp and fine and you name it. But it's not true. Nothing will shake this universe. We built some of the most, you know, prestigious cars these days. And oh, how we want to own a Bima and a Benz and an Audi. Call the names, man. We always wish we could because we want to sit and drive. We just want to chillax and drive. But guess what? We commend all those who brought those inventions into being. But the truth is, they can't sit and drive them. And there is no promise. Everybody has to put those cars on some coverage because they may lose it. The driver can fall asleep. There can be some mechanical failure. These cars can crash. But God's creation never crashes. Are you seeing what I cited? There is one who sustains the earth. There's somebody who keeps this. You get up and you want fresh air, you get fresh air. You get up and you want some light, and there is light. Enough that you need. Properly gauged, because you don't want the sun too hot. I wonder what's happening in Portmore sometimes. We get it a little hotter. We're not gauging it. But God knows how to control things. He is sustainer. So that plane that you go up in, wanting to reach, say, Cairo Airport from New York, 13 long hours. I have flown a couple times that route and I thought, wow, 13 hours? That long, man. And I remember one of my friends who is a pilot, and Paul would sit me down. As a matter of fact, he would show me to a cockpit and he would tell me all of what these gadgets are, and he will let me know what to touch, what and what and what. And he tells me that, listen, Spencer, I'm telling you the truth. People see me as a pilot and people, you know, just wish they were pilots. Some young boys, my son thinks that he wants to be a pilot. And then he says, but every day I'm wondering, will I come back home? And he says, two times in particular, he said, Spencer, two times in flying, that I am a wreck. And if they know me, there would not be 400 or 200 or 150 people behind me. Because when I'm taking off, it's dangerous. And when I'm landing, it's dangerous. And he said, the people who would sit behind me don't even know how much my heart going. But he gets the plane in the sky, and then he has to compose, and he has to, you know, turn his instrument on and speak in a calm voice. Welcome on board, and this is your pilot,
pilot speaking, and you're going to get there, and such a place look nice waiting on you. Temperature is nice there, but will we get there? He said, I have a tendency to relax when the all autopilot is on, and then you know, you can relax a bit, but you still don't know. And he said, don't you know sometimes it's like I'm traveling in a bomb? And he said, listen, if you know the amount of gas that is in reserve that I carry, and the gas I'm using up, and if this blows up, and you cut your tin, relaxing, sleeping, reading a book, all is peace and safety until it gets into the crazy hands of somebody who says, let's just run it into that building over there. There is a sustainer. There's one we can trust with our lives. There's one who is in control of everything. Hello, there's one who is not nervous. There's one whose heart doesn't beat. It doesn't palpitate because, you know, of some uncertainties. The truth is, brothers and sisters, let me tell you this. He is the Almighty One, the All-Sufficient One. He is Christ. And when we are in His hands, we're safe. We are safe. He's sustainer of creation. Through Him, all things hold together. Apart from Him, atomic fission, as the pilot would say to me, would explode the universe. There is enough in this universe to cause a catastrophic scenario. There is enough in this world that can cause, a matter of fact, if the sun goes out of control, one day you are like butter in the sun. Did you know that? If the heavens open up and the rain pours and it doesn't stop, or if a hurricane, a mother nature fury begins, and somebody doesn't speak to the wind and the waves, and somebody who doesn't, you know, give some orders, then we're salt. But there's a sustainer. There's a sustainer of the universe. Through Him, all things hold together. He keeps it together in the form in which He created it. And that's what Hebrews 1:3 is also intimating. He keeps it together in Christ alone. In Christ alone. But look at this one. He says His headship is over the church. He is head over the church. Now the church is His body, and you understand that concept, right? The word body is really a metaphor that is describing our union with Christ. That he's saying that we're united with Christ. We share space, a relationship with Him. And so that you need to know that the church is His body. And this is a powerful statement, because the church is not just an organization. Please remember that it is a living thing. It is an organism. And what gives it this life? What gives it this life is the very life of Christ. And you must understand that it's not built on us. It's not for us to desecrate. It's not for us to, you know, play church in. For sometimes that's what we do. We desecrate it. we play church and we fail to realize that God is the head of the church. And so as the head of the human body is one with the body, so Christ is corporately one in life and destiny with his redeemed of all ages. And if you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 13, you will understand the truth about that, how we are baptized into his body. Do you know what that means? A lot of people talk about baptism, and sometimes they are talking about only one baptism. This right here where the ensemble members are seated, underneath there's a baptismal pool. Water gets in. We baptize some people who got saved. And it's just sad to note that some church people just talk about them baptism all them life. Well, this baptism that is made mention here is not any kind of water baptism. When you are baptized into the body of Christ, that's what takes place when you are converted. It is the act of the Holy Spirit whereby he immerses you into the family of God. Understand that that is the first baptism and the most important baptism. No other baptism is that important. And so sometimes when some people come here and said, I want to transfer my membership, and I'm asked to do an interview with them, sometimes and I ask, where were you baptized? They said, I was baptized here, there, and it's almost everywhere. Some people have had four baptisms, especially some who are coming from some churches that believe that the moment you tell a lie or the moment you sin, duck you again. It's not in the Bible. And for you to become a member of their church, mark you, I said their church, then you have to be baptized. You can't receive membership unless you are baptized here, sir. Who am I to dictate like that? I don't have a church. I'm just a servant in a church. And who am I to tell you that you must be baptized in the name of only Jesus or in the name of only Father? Folks, you get saved, grow up. Grow up in the word for God's sake, and don't let people keep ducking you. Don't let people keep telling you which direction should duck you in. And don't let people take advantage of you, because it was in the Corinthian church, elders. A lot of stuff come in and they are telling you, for example, you need another deliverance. You better watch which deliverance service you say you're going. For my first deliverance was when I came to Jesus. And when he accepts me after I have confessed my sins, after I repented of my sins and he accepted me into the family of God, then now I know I'm a part of the family of God. I'm cleansed in his fountain. I'm washed in his blood. And now joint here with Jesus as I travel along. And that's what makes me a part of the body of Christ. Careful, folks, because some of these people who said they are now the apostles, some of these people who now say they are the prophets, some of these people who now say they are the reverends, and they are the bishops, and they are the pastors. Hello, folks. Long before me know any title, call me Spencer. Me afraid of them think they're bad. I'm only a sinner saved by grace. For we have to be so careful. Watch it, folks. Your biggest deliverance took place when you were broken from your sin, because all of us were born in sin, bound by sin, became burdened by sin. And when Christ met us, he sets us free, and we are free indeed. After that, read your Bible and pray. Worship God. Work for God. Witness for God. Listen, folks, if devil enter your house, cast them out in the name of Jesus. Don't tell anybody you're going to any deliverance service, and then them take you read some psalm, spin you around and turn you around and leave you confused and dizzy. Can I talk to the church? Understand your position in Christ. Understand who you are in Christ. You can cast out a demon for yourself. You can pray for a breakthrough for yourself. You don't have to put any $35,000 on the table and wait for any special blessing. You don't have to stand in any line for any blessing. You are God's possession. You are in Christ, and Christ alone. Embrace this now, folks. For heaven's sake, just embrace this. You have the supremacy of Christ to rejoice about. You have the sufficiency of Christ to rejoice about. You are in Christ, in position. Your elder told you last week, you have passport. Folks, know the image of the invisible God. Know who is the author of all creation. I feel sweet. Can you rejoice about that? Come on, say in Christ alone. In Christ alone. It doesn't matter what comes to the church. It's in Christ alone. In Christ alone. Nobody else. Nothing more important but in Christ alone. I have some rights. I have some authorities. In Christ alone. And this Christ has given us some authorities. If you don't mind, appreciate this storm coming. The time has left. The time is really gone, but I feel like I'd open it to you. I feel like I'd open the book to you today. You understand? For Christ has given me some rights to even preach long. Have you ever gotten some rights? Some privileges in life? You know what I'm talking about, right? The very job you have and the position you sit. I can recall being given some positions in life, like to speak to the nation's highest table. I've gone to the JLP table to speak on the PNP and the NDM. As they recline sometimes for whether they call it retreat or you name it. And I said, God, well, you know, me kind of nervous though. But they, when you get there, give you some privileges. In the yard, somebody tells you where to park. You get a special seat to sit down on. It's in a special place, the house, the Jamaica house. And I thought, a little midis from down at St. Elizabeth. Down at Nightingale Grove, people think that this is just a bird. But then I thought, who gives me this authority? It's not only them giving me some right to speak. The last one I was at before the PNP, the meeting office, the Prime Minister said, take as long as you want, Rev. And I said, I wonder if you know what you're saying. Can we go beyond our, you know? Maybe you wouldn't have any more conference for the day. Somebody knew me that I taught in Waterford. And say they heard I was in the States, and they invited me to speak at the World Bank to have devotion early in the morning and I walk in and I see lots of folks. Their eyes were now on me to listen, and I want to speak from the golden rule. Do unto others as they would have, as you would have them do unto you. And I noticed I was escorted in. I felt like, well, I'm a dignitary here. Yes, for Christ. An ambassador for Christ. And although I'm shaking in my boots and I'm nervous, there are some world leaders that are going to be in this devotion, I was informed. And this is Little Spencer from Nightingale Grove. Thank you for always reminding me of that, brother. But I'm given some rights, yeah? Some authority. Hallelujah. And I used it up. My family and I were on a ship. And all of a sudden, our room bell rang. And this person says, Spencer Colquhoun. And I said, yes. Well, I want to tell you, know that my name is so-and-so, and I'm one of the manager on board. I notice you and your family are on board, and I'm so excited. We rub shoulders in school. And then after we left school, you usually come as a student pastor to preach in this little place called Big Woods. Way in the woods. But he's now one of the managers on the ship. And then he says to me, I want you to know that you have privileges here. We were now finding stuff in our room. We were now not waiting on any line to get to the dining table. Table spread for you. Walk in any time. Ask for whatever you want. Then one day he entered the table and he entered the area and he met me and we embraced and talked and he met my wife and the children. And I thought, wow, what a thing. Last person I expect to meet is a schoolmate. But he gives me some right and some power on the ship. I enjoyed that. Folks, I could continue the list, but I want to tell you this, that there is one who gives Spencer some rights, some privileges, some authority. There's somebody who has taken me from the lowest of the low, from the horrible pit, from the miry clay, and has planted my feet upon the rock to stay. He is the Supreme Lord. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. It matters when he exalts you and gives you rights and privileges. It matters because there's none like him. There's none before him. There's none after him. He is Lord. He is large. He is in charge. That's Jesus. That's Jesus. Can I hear his name? Can I hear his name? Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Bless his name. I'm not done just yet, but I'll finish after the storm. Lord willing, next week, we pick up on this note, folks. Christ alone. Come on, let everybody say Christ. Come on, put your hands together for Christ alone. Give a wave offering to Christ alone. Give a hallelujah shout to Christ alone. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a word. What a word. The Lord's our rock, in him we hide, a shelter in the time of storm, secure whatever ill betide, a shelter in a time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. As we sing this hymn, maybe this morning you are in need of shelter. We invite you to come to the altar. You don't know the Lord as your personal Savior. You need a shelter. We invite you to come. Shall we stand?
The Lord's our rock, in Him we hide, a shelter in the time of storm. Secure whatever ill betide, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, yes, a weary land. Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in a time of storm. A shade by day, defense by night, a shelter in the time of storm. No fears alarm, no foes affright, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land.
Oh,
a weary land, a weary land. Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. The raging storm may round us be, a shelter in the time of storm. We'll never leave our safe retreat, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, yes, a weary land. Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, rock divine, oh, refuge there, a shelter in the time of storm. Be thou our helper ever near, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm.
Before we close this service, I would love to challenge somebody who is feeling very timid, very fearful of what you think could happen, and you're not sheltered, you are not covered in the arms of Jesus. We want to pray for you this morning. A very serious thing. You're here this morning, and you're not spiritually covered under the blood of Jesus Christ. And I guess everybody in this congregation could tell you, you're vulnerable. You're vulnerable. And anything could happen to you this time of storm, in the time of storm. We are challenging you today that there is a shelter and covering in Jesus Christ. We want to know who you are to help you today. You're fearful, and you're not quite sure what will happen physically and spiritually to you. We want to help with all eyes closed and all heads bowed. What a time to give a challenge for Jesus like this. Maybe you want to raise your hand or step forward and say, I am that person. And I want to make sure that In the event of anything, my life is in Christ and in Christ alone. Anybody like that? My second challenge is, if you're not sure and you still don't want to come, singing the chorus one more time, you would be singing a lie. You'd be telling a lie. And I would challenge you very seriously. To do it before it's too late. Let's sing the chorus and then we close the service. Sing a weary land, Jesus
is a rock in a weary land,
a shelter in the time of storm. Raise your right hand. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lord, lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Take your seats, please.
I'm going to ask those who are remaining for communion service to just organize yourselves. We'll be proceeding just as we did last time. And those who are not staying, that you leave quietly so that, and we ask the members to come forward.